you please pay attention to the screen at this time?
Question is, will I ever leave you? The answer is no.
No, 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 no.
Question is, will I ever leave you? The answer is no,
no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no,
no. Oh, I love the Lord, for He's so dear to me. And oh, He died that I might be free. I was asked this question years ago,
and the answer is still no.
Now the question is, will I do His will? And it's
yeah, 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 yeah,
yeah. I was asked this question,
and the answer is yes.
I want to entitle this anointed message today, The State of the American Church, The Frog in the Kettle. The State of the American Church, The Frog in the Kettle. Would you say the frog in the kettle?
The frog in the kettle.
For the past several weeks now, I've been preparing myself for this Family and Friends Day service. The Holy Spirit began to download some things to me as to what He would have me to say and how He would have me to present this anointed message to you today. He gave me several songs to play and two illustrated videos that will be included in this anointed message. The first song you just heard was the Winans, entitled The Question Is. It was released back in 1981. Now, at this point, some of you may be saying to yourself, what does this song have to do with your preaching? I'm glad you asked. Now, in this song, if you were paying attention to the lyrics of the song, there were three questions asked, but I only showed two. There were three questions asked. The first question was, Lord, will I ever leave you? The second question that was asked was, the Lord asked me, will I do his will? Will I do his will? And then the third thing that I didn't play, but the third thing was, when will Jesus return? So it asked these questions. Will I ever leave you? Amen. Will I do his will? And when will Jesus return? Now, during this anointed message, you should be able to respond to the first two questions. Will I ever leave you? And will I do his will? In my 32 years of being in full-time ministry as a pastor, the last 5 to 10 years have been very, very challenging to me. Not only for me, but for a lot of pastors who are pastoring churches in America. Why is this? Because the American church is not like what it used to be. Let me say it again. The American church is not what it like, is not what it used to be. That's because a paradigm shift has taken place in America. Now, what do I mean by paradigm shift? A paradigm shift is defined as an important change that happens when the usual way of thinking about or doing something is replaced by a new and different way. Now, the church is beginning to be burned by a slow change in the cultural temperature. Instead of the church changing the culture around it, the surrounding culture has changed the church. Okay? The church looks more like the world than the world looks more like the church. Let me say it again. The church is beginning to look more like the world than the world being influenced by the church. You know what Jesus said about that? He said this in Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. He says this, "You are the salt of the earth." He's talking about his people. He says, we are the what? The salt of the earth. But then I like this statement. This is what it really says. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? You see, it is no longer good for anything. You hear what it said? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. In other words, if a seasoning has no flavor, it has no value. You ever taste some food that didn't have no seasoning at all? What we call that? Bland. That's just bland. That's just nasty. Amen. It's just nasty. That just don't have no taste at it. Amen. And so if a season has no flavor, it has no value. If the church, which is the body of Christ, make no effort to affect the world around us, then we are of little value to God. We have little value to God. You see, the church is losing its flavor because secularism and materialism have impacted the America so profoundly that the country and the church has lost much of its spirituality. People are not as spiritual as they used to be. Did you all hear what I just said? People are not as spiritual as they used to be. As a matter of fact, former President Barack Obama once said back in 2006, he says this, given the increasing diversity of America's population, the danger of secularism has never been greater. Whatever we once were, we are no longer just a Christian nation. We are also a Jewish nation, a Muslim nation, a Buddhist nation, a Hindu nation, and a nation of non-believers. And I quoted him exactly like he said it. This is evident all around us. The Ten Commandments that used to be displayed in most courthouses have been taken down. John 3:16, signs has been barred from a lot of sporting events. You remember you used to go to a sporting event and every time they were getting ready to kick a field goal, somebody would have a sign up that say John 3:16. You won't see that no more. Praying in the name of Jesus in most public places is no longer accepted. If you get a chance to pray at City Hall or do something, they say it's all right to pray just as long as you don't use the name of Jesus. Saying Merry Christmas is no longer acceptable in a lot of public places either. What is it now? What do we have to say? Happy holidays. We can't say Merry Christmas. Isn't Christmas about Christ?
Amen.
Then why we can't say Christmas?
Amen.
But society has changed where we have to say happy holidays. I can go on and on about the downward spiral of Christianity in America. Increasingly, Christianity is treated like smoking. You can do it, but only in designated areas. Our government is saying that there's no place for faith in the public square. The only time that we really want to bring God out is when tragedy hit, then everybody wants to find a place to pray. But as long as everything is going all right in America, we want to leave God out of America. Some time ago, a book was written on church life called The Frog in the Kettle. The Frog in the Kettle. It was an interesting title designed to call to mind how it is so easily. No, the first one. Yeah, you're good. You're right. How it's so easy to drift into trouble. Perhaps you could subtitle the book, How to Boil a Frog. How to Boil a Frog. The way to boil a frog is not to put him in a pot of boiling water. In other words, if you drop a frog in a kettle of boiling water, it will jump out immediately in reaction to the pain. On the other hand, if you put the frog in water that is room temperature, it is very pleasant at first. And as you slowly heat it up, the frog will remain in the kettle. That's because he feels perfectly comfortable. By the time it gets a little warmer, he's swimming around like he's in a frog jacuzzi. But finally, when it's boiling, it's too late. His strength has been gradually sapped, leaving him powerless to hop out. That's how you boil a frog. That's how you boil a frog. Now, the hypothesis is that the change in the temperature was so gradual. I want y'all to think about this. The change in the temperature was so gradual that the frog does not realize it's boiling to death. Let me say it again. It's so gradual that the frog don't even know that it's boiling to death. The story is often true. Next one. It is often used as a metaphor for the inability or the unwillingness of people to react to or be aware of threats that arise gradually. While the results of the experiment are in question, It is a good metaphor for where the church is today in American culture. This is a good time to revisit the idea in light of the recent events that signal the decline of Christianity in our nation. Yes, it's declining. It's declining. Most church leaders are wondering why generating momentum in the local church seemed harder than ever before. Trying to get people to come to church. People just don't have an interest just to come to church. The conversation about momentum and shifting attendance trends and the lack of people hunger for spiritual things is happening at every level of church, including some of the largest and fastest growing churches in North America. Everyone is feeling at least two realities. First, even people who attend church have stopped as frequently as they used to. There are a lot of people that used to attend church that are no longer going to church. Even in communities that are home to growing churches, the overall percentage of the population that attends church and people's desire for spiritual things continue to drop, especially among children, youth, and young adults under the age of 30. We're losing our kids. We are losing the younger generation between the ages of 18 and 30. We're losing them. There are so many people who don't love the church no more. They just don't love the church no more. Some because they don't know Christ. Some because they've been hurt by the church. Amen. Something went wrong in the church and they got hurt by somebody and they just stopped. Amen. And others simply don't find it necessary for their lives. Now, here are a few answers that people give of why they just don't do church no more. Number one, some people see church as not relevant to their lives. They feel like church is not doing nothing for me. It's not helping me. I don't understand why you do church. I don't understand why people get up in the morning and just do church. So they don't feel the church is relevant. Two, some people allow sports and entertainment have taken the place of church. It's amazing that I've been doing a lot of traveling, and the last time I was traveling, I was in Cincinnati, and I was on a plane, and I met one of the guys that worked for the Buffalo Bills, and he was traveling, but he's not required to travel. But and I was seeing all of these people, the hotel I was staying in, because the hotel to stay in the bill was like almost about $300 because the game was in town. People will spend $500 to $1,000 to fly to a game, spend $300 for the hotel, spend about $200 or $300 for a ticket for a game that lasts 2 hours. And that team is not guaranteed to win. Some people just don't feel welcome in church. They feel like when they go to churches, there's no love. People don't greet them. They don't make them feel loved. They don't make them feel needed. They don't make them feel appreciated. And people say, well, hey, I get that out in the world. Why should I go to church? The digital age. You can go to church sitting at a screen at home. You can watch church on the internet. On your phone. So, you know, I can stay in my pajamas and I can get church at home. Another thing, family matters and other activities are taking priority over the church. Amen. We're so absorbed into family that our family should be absorbed into the church. But we're so caught up into so many other things that has our attention that we don't attend church. And the biggest reason people give for not going to church is they feel judged, or feel it is a judgmental atmosphere that they're going to condemn me, and I don't need the preacher putting my business out there. I don't need the preacher talking about me. But let me tell you the real reason why the church is declining in America. Yeah, we're feeling the pinch here. We've gone from two services to one. But we're on the rebound and we're moving back up. But let me tell you the reason why the church is declining in America and what it has done to our society. I want you to pay attention to the screen. We're going to watch this clip called Too Busy.
Satan called the worldwide convention. In his opening address to his evil angels, Satan said,
"We can't keep the Christians from going to church. We can't keep them from reading their Bibles and knowing the truth. We can't even keep them from forming an intimate, abiding relationship experience in Christ. If they gain that connection with Jesus, our power over them is broken. So let them go to their churches. Let them have their conservative lifestyles, but steal their time so they can't gain that relationship with Jesus Christ."
How shall we do this?
"Keep them busy in the non-essentials of life and invent innumerable schemes to occupy their minds. Tempt them to spend, and borrow. Persuade the wives to go to work for long hours and the husbands to work 6 to 7 days each week, 10 to 12 hours a day, so they can afford empty lifestyles. Keep them from spending time with their children. As their family fragments, soon their home will offer no escape from the pressures of work. Overstimulate their minds so that they cannot hear that still small voice. Entice them to play the radio whenever they drive, to keep the TVs, DVDs, CDs, and even their PCs going constantly in their home, and see to it that every store and restaurant in the world plays non-biblical music constantly. This will jam their minds and break that union with Christ. Fill the coffee tables with magazines and newspapers. Pound their minds with news 24 hours a day. Invade their driving moments with billboards. Flood their mailboxes with junk mail, mail order catalogs, sweepstakes, and every kind of newsletter and promotional offering free products, services, and false hopes. Keep skinny, beautiful models on the magazines so the husbands will believe that external beauty is what's important. That will fragment those families quickly. Even in their recreation, let them be excessive. Have them return home from their recreation exhausted, disquieted, and unprepared for the coming week. Don't let them go out in nature to reflect on God's wonders. Send them to amusement parks, sporting events, concerts, and movies. Keep them busy, busy, busy. And when they meet for spiritual fellowship, involve them in gossip and small talk so that they leave with troubled consciences and unsettled emotions. Go ahead, let them be involved in soul winning, but crowd their lives with so many good causes that they have no time to seek power from Jesus. Soon, they will be working in their own strength, sacrificing their health and family for the good of the cause. It will work. It will work."
It was quite a convention. The evil angels went eagerly to their assignments, causing Christians everywhere to get more busy and more rushed. I guess the question is, has the devil been successful at his scheme? You be the judge. Does busy mean being under Satan's yoke?
Busy. Whenever I put a message together, I don't put it together to entertain people. I put it together with what God is trying to say to us. One of Satan's most subtle deception is to keep us perpetually busy. He constantly bombards us with distraction that he hopes it will ultimately prevent us from entering into God's kingdom. Sometimes a distraction may not be wrong in and of itself, but it can divert our attention from more important matters. And if we're not careful, it can cause us to forfeit our opportunity. This is what the Bible says in 1 Peter 5:8. It says, and I'm going to read it from the ESV. It said, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. Now, what does that mean to be distracted? Distraction means a thing that prevents someone from giving full attention to something that is important. Every day, you exchange a day of your life for something. It as if at the start of life, each of us was issued a certain amount of coins. They're hidden inside a large machine so that we don't know how many we were issued or how many we have left. Each day the machine issues a new coin. It may be the last coin we get, or we may get many more. All of us know that the average person in America gets between 70 and 80 years worth. But some get far less, and a few may get more. You take each day's coin and you exchange it for something. A day at work, or school, or shopping, or church, or leisure, or whatever. Once spent, you can never get the coin back to spend them differently. The art of living wisely is largely a matter of spending your coin on the things that really matter in light of eternity and not frivolously wasting them. Living wisely is difficult because often the choice is not between the bad and the good, but between the good and the best. In part of my opening text of the book of Haggai, which is the second shortest book in the Old Testament, it has a potent message. It tells us to put first things first in our lives. Look at somebody and say, you need to put first thing first in your life. It was written to a people like us who would have told you that God must be first. They believe that. We believe that. We hear it all the time and saying, God is first in my life. But they had drifted into a way of life where their intellectual belief in the supremacy of God was not reflected in the way that they were living. In other words, they were giving God lip service. They were saying God was first in their life, but it didn't show in their actions. It did not show in their activity. They gave lip service to the priority of God. But in fact, they lived with other priorities. Therefore, God sent the prophet to help these people to get their priorities in line with what they knew they should be doing. A lot of us, we know what we're supposed to be doing, but we procrastinate. We don't do what we say we're going to do when it comes to the things of God. At least 14 years had passed after their captivity. They were prisoners in a foreign land, and God brought them back. And he wanted to be the center of their attention. But yet, as they began to live their lives and go on and on and on, 14 years passed. The people got caught up in their routine of life. They were farming. They were building houses. They were raising families and that sort of thing. They got used to life without the temple. Did y'all hear what I just said? They got used to life without the temple. In other words, they got used to life without the church. Even their leaders, Zerubbabel, the governor, and Joshua, the high priest, hadn't gotten used to things as they were. Well, this is the way society is headed. And to that scene, God raised up Haggai. And 2 months later, Zechariah to proclaim his message to the remnant. And this is what God said to his people. This is what he said to church people. This is what he's saying to you today. He said this in Haggai chapter 1, verses 5 through 7. He says this: "Now therefore, thus said the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and you bring in little. You eat, but ye have not enough. You drink, but ye are not filled with drink. You clothe you, but there is none warm. And he that earneth wages to put it into a bag with holes. Thus said the Lord of hosts, consider your ways." That's what's happening in America. Some of us, we're trying to get ahead. No matter what we do, we're not able to get ahead. And the more we get, the more we want. You see, the people had not given God first place in their lives. Oh yeah, he was a part of their lives, but he was not first in their lives. Their work was not fruitful or productive. God said, okay, all right, you want to do it? I'm going to let you do it. I'm going to let you handle it. I'm going to let you do your thing. And when you do your thing and it don't work, then you want to come back to me. You want to set me on the shelf. And then when you need me, you want to take me off the shelf. You see, God will, generally speaking, not compete for our attention. God, in other words, either he's first or he's not. God's not going to compete with your attention. Amen. I remember some tragic things that was in my life. I was going through depression, a deep thing of depression. I was very suicidal. I was confused. I wasn't married to my wife at the time, but the devil was playing with my mind. He would tell me, he said, God told me not to be with you. He told me not to be with you. And then the next day I say, God told me to be with you. Then I say, God told me not to be with you. And this went on for years. Okay. Finally, my wife said, okay, but you know, she wasn't my wife then. She said, okay, I tell you what, let me handle this. You ain't gonna take me through no more changes. All right, this is it. She hung up on me. And every time I tried to call back, she didn't answer. In other words, she was saying, either we gonna be together or we not. And as you see, we've been together, amen, married for 33 years and been together for 37 years. But she came to the point and said, hey, you're not going to put me through these changes anymore. And this is what God is saying to us as a church. Either I am first or I am not. See, if we will not withdraw from things that obsess and exalt us into solitude and silence, he will usually leave us to our own devices, says author and professor Dr. Dallas Willard. God said, okay, I'm gonna let you live the life that you want to live. I'm gonna let you do it how you want to do it. And if you want to put me in your schedule every now and then, okay, that'll be fine. But you're not going to find no happiness, and you're not going to find no fulfillment. Yeah, you'll have temporary happiness. You'll have temporary fulfillment. But I don't want you to live a life of happiness. I want you to have joy. You see, there's a difference between happiness and joy. Happiness is based on circumstances. Joy is based on the joy of the Lord being your strength in the midst of things not going the way that they should. Now, compare that theology to the reality of contemporary Christian life. Are we too busy for God? Oh, we say it, but I see it.